Welcome, my dearly beloved brothers and sisters, sons and daughters, to another episode of This Eagle's Eyes. And I'm sure you are much blessed by last week's teaching on the communion of saints or the cloud of witnesses. During my travels in Nigeria, I've come across many young people there who have experienced this cloud of witnesses, been sent by God to talk with them. But we forgot to mention something very important last week. You cannot initiate asking them to come and talk to you.
Absolutely not.
See, that's something very important we've missed. That would be like Saul seeking the spirit from the witch of Endor.
Exactly.
Yes.
So if we initiate it, right? And secondly, we should not even ask them for like prayer, ask them to pray for you.
No.
What the Catholic Church teaches.
No.
Can I share a testimony about that? After I had my visitation from Philip, another spirit appeared trying to pretend to be someone similar. And so I thought, wow, he's glowing. He looks majestic. But something didn't sit right in my spirit. So I said, did Jesus Christ come in the flesh? And he got so angry, and he said, why do you people always have to ask that question? And he left. So, yes, this has to be God initiates this. Absolutely.
Like once I had an encounter with a spirit, and from all outwardness, it looked like a saint, you know. But I felt a little jarring in my spirit. It was something wrong. So when I posed this question, he just refused to answer that question and went on speaking. So I would stop the spirit again and say, tell me this question. And would just evade that question and went on speaking as if giving me revelation, you know.
Right.
And then when I forcibly stopped him, said, tell me this. And with such a shriek of anger, it left.
Wow.
So you cannot initiate invitation like say, Lord, send me an angel or send me a spirit to talk. That's wrong.
No.
You cannot do that. They're just sent by God like angels to bring a message. Or when you're down with sorrow, to give you a word of encouragement.
Exactly.
Right.
Now we come to another subject called... Now again, this may cause some disturbances in the established circles. But it is another very valid spiritual experience written in the Bible. However, the title that I'm going to use is never used in the Bible.
Right.
But the experience is mentioned there. So it's called Aura, A-U-R-A. And I'd like to tell both of you a nice story before we start on this topic. So there was a young man who went on a mountain hike. And as he was walking, he found himself above some low-lying clouds. It happens, right? When you're walking up the mountain. And with the sun behind him, he looked down and saw not only his shadow, but saw a brilliant display known as a broken specter. Broken. This phenomena resembles a rainbow halo encircling the shadow of the person. It occurs when the sunlight reflects back off the clouds below, and this is a nature-made aura. Have you experienced, have you heard of this?
Yeah, I've seen that from aircraft.
Oh, please tell us.
Well, you know, when you're flying above the clouds and you look down when the sun's in a certain location in conjunction to where the aircraft is, you can see that all the time.
Like a halo.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Now, so that's an aura.
Yes.
Nature-made aura.
Right.
Right? With rainbow colors all around a person like a halo. Now, that is amazing because in Acts chapter 5, verse 15, we read that the Apostle Peter had an aura of God around his shadow. And as a result of that, his shadow seemed to heal the sick. Now, you and I know too well that no shadow can heal anybody.
No.
So for the shadow of Peter to heal someone, it cannot be just his own shadow, but the glory of God around that.
Right. In the Greek, when it talks about his shadow, mm-hmm. it's talking about that inward deposit and the effulgence, the outward shining of what's been deposited within him has a certain sphere of influence.
Right.
So that's what was being released. Mm. Some people with their spiritual eyes can see that. Most people can't. But that's what it is. It's that outward effulgence of that inward deposit. Mm.
I have read about some Buddhist monks who practice meditation in the caves in the Tibet, you know, mm-hmm. where they become very heightened in their spiritual activity. And they also claim that their spiritual eyes are open mm-hmm. or like their third eye been open. And when they look at others, they can see aura around the person, which tells them their spirituality.
Right.
And they could say from the aura, even when a person is sick.
Yes.
There's a different, like you say, affluence?
Effulgence, yeah.
Effulgence coming out.
Right.
Something that comes out from your body that shows in color or the darkness of it. Mm-hmm. Can you explain more?
I like to use this example. Sometimes you can see it, sometimes you can't, but you can experience this. Mm-hmm. Have you ever walked into a room where there has been an argument between people? You weren't there for the argument. Mm-hmm. When you walk in, there's this darkness you can feel. Mm-hmm. That's that very
right.
same thing.
Mm-hmm. You know, some many years ago, maybe about 10, 15 years ago, I went to an electronic store in Oakland. So as I was browsing by this certain counter for something that I was planning to buy, no? And I couldn't find what I was looking for. So I signaled to one of the sales assistants to come and help me. So as he came towards me, it was a American guy. And then he stepped back. So, say, what is oh? You know, I didn't understand. No? Say, please come closer. I need to ask you. And he took two steps forward. He went back. Oh. So why is he saying oh? Is he practicing to be Santa Claus? Oh. You know. So I just didn't understand. So I said, let me go closer to him. And when I went closer to him, he ran away. He said, oh, it's too strong. It's too strong. I said, what is too strong? And he wouldn't come to serve me at all. You know.
Hmm.
Then later on, I found out that he was a practicing Buddhist. And he could sense that aura around
right.
that was repugnant to him or overwhelming to him,
mm-hmm.
you know. And I'm sure you have seen a picture of William Branham photographed with a halo over his head.
Yes.
Have you seen that?
Yes, I have.
So that's an aura.
Yeah.
Right? And I remember speaking with one of a prophet friend of mine some years ago. He said, the gifts of the Holy Spirit that's deposited in us appears like bands of rainbow colors.
Mm-hmm.
And it appears like an aura all around a person, you know. So in the spirit, like an angel, when they see us, they can see all that. And let's say you have the gifts of healing, right? It may appear like a green color. And if you have other gifts, red color, blue color, and all that. And the thickness of the band signifies how great the anointing of the gift is upon your life.
Wow.
So the greater the anointing, the greater comes the thickness. So that's how the different colors of the gifts of the Holy Spirit appears like an aura around a person.
I know you've experienced this. You've had photographs taken of you where you're nothing but white
mm-hmm.
light.
Mm.
I've had that. Others have had that. White light actually incorporates every color spectrum mm-hmm. of the light spectrum, mm-hmm. but it is the purest, the strongest, the brightest. And so cameras can catch things human eyes are not trained to mm-hmm. catch because they catch different frequencies. So today, especially with everybody walking around with a very highly attuned camera in their pocket, can catch supernatural things they don't even realize.
You know, speaking of that, since you mentioned that, when the first photograph was taken of you and me, I think it was in Moravian Falls at the Gathering Church, mm-hmm. where they photographed and appeared all like light.
Yes.
And of you, it was taken at the Shekinah Worship Center, where they have photographed you.
No, that was in Neville School in Australia.
Oh, Neville School. Mm. I think it was also taken of Pastor Joe Sweet, because he mentioned to me about this incident.
Oh, okay. Well,
so a picture was taken, and he appeared all white. And then he had, so when they looked at it, they wondered maybe it was a confluence of lights that bounced off a camera and that had produced this image, no? So to verify that, he had the person who took the picture to sit in the same direction the following day.
Mm.
And under the same lighting conditions, like it was on the previous day, mm-hmm. take a picture, and it never happened again. So on that one particular day, the Lord allowed a physical camera to capture something of the spiritual realm.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that which is inside can also flow out.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Flow out even vast distances.
Yeah.
To touch a person.
Very much.
That answers the question how the Lord Jesus is able to speak a word and people who are far away can be touched.
He sends forth his word.
Right.
As like light.
Right? Amen. Like even that woman with the issue of the blood who came within that aura.
Yes.
And when she touched the Lord, she received a healing.
Right. Yes.
So this is another valid spiritual experience. Mm-hmm. And we have a scripture for that where the shadow of the Apostle Peter healed the sick.
Yes.
So the next spiritual experience that we want to talk about is what I would call the energizer experience. Please do not think that I am advertising for the energizer.
Bunny.
Not the bunny.
The bunny man.
Oh, the batteries.
No, not the batteries.
Okay.
This is just the word that I coined to explain this because I couldn't find another better word for that.
Mm.
You know? So what is this energizer experience? It's a strengthening that comes through the partaking of spiritual food. It energizes with enduring strength and ability. And the few examples that we can look at is Genesis chapter 32, verses 24 to 31, that the angel blessed Jacob and his entire destiny changed. Something changed inside that affected him and it changed him. And then we read in Exodus chapter 16, how the children of Israel ate manna from heaven. And amazingly, for 40 long years, not a single person were feeble.
Right.
Neither did anyone fall sick. Psalms 105, verse 37 says, they were not weak, they were not strengthless, they were super strong.
Mm-hmm.
So the eating of that heavenly food energized them to remain super strong. And we also read about the 74 elders of Israel who ate with God. Something was given them to eat. And then the prophet Elijah eating cakes and drank water that was brought by an angel.
Right.
In 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 5 to 7. Now that is amazing, you know. After eating the two cakes or muffins, like I would say, blueberry muffin, you know?
Yeah.
And one was blueberry, there was cranberry.
Okay.
All right? So after eating that and drinking two cups of water, the angel told him, you are now going to walk in that strength. 40 days and 40 nights.
Wow.
It strengthened him.
Yeah.
It energized him with such a strength. And then we read that Ezekiel and the Apostle John had scrolls that were given to them. And after eating it, they prophesied. like the word entered into them, mm-hmm. and they begin to prophesy. And we read in Revelation chapter 2, verse 7 and verse 17, where the Lord Jesus said, to the overcomers, they will be given to eat of the fruit from the tree of life and eat hidden manna. So in all the scriptures, we find that they were given something to eat. And after eating spiritual food, it energized their body with supernatural strength.
What about when Jesus said, I have meat to eat that you know not of?
The amazing thing about that is, the Lord said, when he who eats that meat will live forever, mm-hmm. he will not even die.
Wow. So I know what I want for dinner.
All right. Now, have you have experiences like this?
Yeah, actually, we met a man that for, I don't know, 30 years, I think it was, he had manna up here.
Oh.
And anybody that would eat it, if they had sickness or mm-hmm. different things, you know, would take communion, mm-hmm. they would be instantly healed.
Oh, wow.
So we got to taste that a couple of times, mm-hmm. and it was interesting. Yeah, mm-hmm. it had a wonderful taste.
Did something happen to you when you ate it?
I wasn't sick or anything, but mm-hmm. so to me, it was just a confirmation of our faith that, you know, Reshma and I already believe this stuff is real. We know it. We've mm-hmm. had water turned to wine. And so to me, it was like taking a communion and recognizing.
So did that manna taste it like how it's described in the Bible?
Somewhat, yeah. The first time we tasted it, have you ever had a saltine cracker?
No.
Okay, well, at first it was like a cracker, but it was sweetish, had a honey taste mm-hmm. to it. Just very pleasant.
Why is it that when you come to visit me, you don't bring your wife along? She could have added more information.
She probably could have.
Right?
Yeah. I'm remiss. I'll make sure she comes next time.
All right.
Okay.
What about Michael? Have you had any experiences like this?
I've had a couple.
Mm-hmm.
I remember once the Lord gave me a gold coin and told me to eat it.
Mm.
And I didn't have an understanding in that moment, but later the Lord said he was giving me revelation.
Mm-hmm.
And another time when the Lord corrected a situation in my life where I wasn't blessing those that cursed me,
mm-hmm.
Once I repented and began to bless the person that cursed me, an angel appeared and gave me a piece of cake on a plate.
Mm.
So those are the two spiritual food things.
Wow.
That I've experienced.
You know, I remember an experience that I read in the book, Angels on Assignment.
Yes.
Have you read that?
Oh, yeah.
You know that this man of God called Roland Buck.
I've heard of him.
Who lived in Idaho, Boise, Idaho. Hmm. So in the 70s, I think he was very heavy.
No, he was a thin man.
No, before that encounter, before he became thin man.
Oh, well, I met him afterwards.
Okay. Then. Oh, you met him?
Oh, yeah.
So he was a heavy set man, and in one encounter, the angel of God gave him something like a ladder to drink. So when he drank that, instantaneously, 20 pounds dropped off from his body.
Hmm.
And he became slim.
Wow.
To do the work of God. So you must have met him after this incident.
Yeah, I did. When he came on the set of the program.
Mm. So do you remember which year was that?
70, when I met him, 78, 79, yeah.
So another wonderful man of God.
Oh my.
You know, with rich experiences of...
Forerunner.
Yes, having experiences with the angels of God.
He did. He was a forerunner in our generation, and he took flack for that. Boy, howdy.
And he has that character, no?
Yes.
That goes along with that.
Yes.
Experiences.
How can you have an experience with it, an encounter with heaven, and it not change you? That's always been the litmus test for me. Mm-hmm. When people say, well, I had this and that, and then you look at their life and you go, no, you didn't.
Mm-hmm.
Not if you act like that.
Exactly. Isn't it?
Yeah.
Mm. So, anything else we want to add to this? But eating a scroll or fruit that causes a change.
You made me hungry.
Oh.
I'm just believing for Roland Buck's encounter with the With, yeah.
Yeah, with God's the liquid.
No, God's no respecter of persons.
You know, in 1994, the Lord called me to fast for 3 days. So on the third day of the fast, as I was waiting on God, an overwhelming desire came on me to just worship the Lord. So I spent about an hour worshiping the Lord. Towards the end of that hour, an angel of the Lord appeared to me. And this angel that I saw was totally unlike all the other angels that I've seen. His cloth was shimmering with light.
Mm.
And I looked at his face. It was so glorious and very bright. And he stretched out his hand, and there was a silver plate. And on the plate, there were 4 kinds of fruits.
Mm.
And one looked like a papaya cut in a quarter. And there were 3 grapes. And I forgot what's the other 2 fruits, you know. And he said, "Eat this. I brought this for you." And I looked at him. And he, what made me startled was, he said, "These are fruits from the tree of wisdom.
Wow.
Eat them." So wow. I was taken aback. Because I've never heard anything like a tree of wisdom in the Bible, you know. So I thought this must be a false angel. So I asked the Holy Spirit, "Is this a true angel that has come?" I say, "Yes, it's a true angel." Then I asked him, "How come he's talking about the tree of wisdom?" Then the Holy Spirit asked me, "Haven't you read in the word where it says the wisdom that comes from above is pure, is beautiful?" I said, "There, the wisdom is personified as a tree." He said, "Take and eat that." So only then I felt comfortable, you know. I took and ate the fruits. Then I looked at the angel, and he disappeared in a manner by disintegrating, like molecules, you know, from the top of the head to the sole of the feet. They just integrated and came into the center, plop, in a burst of light, he left.
Wow.
I've never seen another disappearance like that before. That was one unique time, you know. And after that encounter, a short while later, the Lord Jesus came. And that's when he began to talk to me about the secrets of the universe. So when he began to share that, because I've eaten that fruit of from the tree of wisdom, whatever he was speaking, I was able to comprehend and understand very easily.
Mm. Wow.
So this thing gives you an energizing effect, boosts you.
Amen. Praise God.
Amen. So you are going to pray for that soup?
I am, and I'll take steps of faith along with it.
All right, my dearly beloved brothers and sisters, sons and daughters, today you learn about another spiritual experience. And please go over all the scriptures that we just gave you and meditate on them. And by God's grace, you may be blessed. God bless you all. Till we meet again next week.